All right, guys, we're live on Santa Maria's lovely day. It's a little cold upstairs in the Williamsburg location. Tempe, do me a favor, close the phone on side.
Yeah, please.
And today we got a fun one, right? We're gonna talk about how to hit the bag properly, some conventional stuff, but definitely some unconventional stuff. One of my pet peeves, I don't really go to the gym too much anymore. I pretty much exercise in the school, but when I used to go to the gym as a kid, some of the things you see on the bag are just ridiculous. If you guys want to just see something fun, just look up like bloopers on bags, guys throwing spinning kicks and falling, just guys punching with weird parts of their hands. My suggestion, and again, you don't have to do this every time, is when you do hit the bag, you get a good pair of boxing gloves, you hit them, especially for those of you with a lot of power. Hitting them with the MMA gloves is a bad idea, it could hurt your wrist and your hand. Hitting it barehanded is okay sometimes if you want to go light and work the conditioning. But again, I'm not a big believer in like crazy hard body hardening too early in your training, because you can get really, really hurt, especially if your technique isn't perfect, right? So the first thing we're gonna do is actually go through different themes that we could hit the bag with, right? Like speed, power, outside fighting, things of that nature. Then I'll show you some combinations, of course, and actually a couple ways you can use the bag to set up your grappling and actually your takedowns, because believe it or not, a bag of this width, right, like a long, skinny bag, is actually good to work your takedown entries as well. It's a little harder to work the finish, obviously, but it's good to work the takedown entries. So I'm just gonna get right into it and keep the questions coming throughout the entire time. I'm gonna answer them to the best of my ability, but then at the end, we're gonna put about 5-10 minutes for just exclusively questions. I won't be showing any technique, we'll just go through some stuff. When I look at it, you don't wanna just do random stuff, right? What you don't wanna do is just literally sit in the bag and throw a basic 1-2-3, your favorite combination over and over and over again, unless that's what you're looking to work. The whole point of working the bag is to work different styles of striking, and then of course we're gonna get into the takedowns too, but different styles of striking. So we're gonna go through like 5 different ways you can hit the bag. I'm gonna do them super short. You would do these in either a 2, a 3, or if your cardio was really good, like a 4-minute round, with anywhere from 30 seconds rest to a minute, right? So theme number one on the bag is speed and elusiveness. You're gonna be hitting it, getting in, getting out, hitting angles. So angle, bam. I'm getting around the bag. I'm not working it too hard. My head's in motion, right? I'm stepping out, I'm moving, throwing my kicks, getting out. So theme number one on the bag is speed combined with elusive fighting. So I'll do it slow though. Let's say I throw 1-2, I always exit. I throw 1-2, I duck out. I throw 1-2, I quarter turn. I never do this. Hit the bag and just look at it. Because you ever see the Enter the Dragon? Bruce Lee says boards don't hit back. Well, bags don't hit back. That's the problem with the bag. It's not firing stuff back at you. That's why, in general, partner drills, imagine I'm hitting my friend's boxing gloves. Bang, bang, he throws. I step out of the way and clear the line. Pop, pop, he throws a hook, I duck under. Pop, pop, goes straight left. I zip out of the way. And the fact that I'm with a partner makes it a lot better, because I have to read the exact line. Now, when you hit the bag the right way, you have to be good at visualizing. I'm here, I threw a 1-2-3, and I ducked out. I'm envisioning that hook coming at me. I throw that 1-2-3, I slide out, I see something I don't like. 1-2, step out with the 3, push back again. Again, the theme of round number one is, again, being elusive, speedy, putting the angles in there, and getting in and out, right? Then you would take your 30-second break, you would take a minute, whatever you decide. Always breathing between the rounds, in through the nose, out through the mouth. And you guys, especially now, should you check out like the Joe Rogan podcast. They got a marine fitness guy on there, and he's talking about the advantages of breathing for fitness. Super cool. Joe Rogan podcast, advantages of breathing for fitness. Really, really cool. Talks about taking calm, slow breaths, like when you're trying to settle yourself down and calm down from an emotional state, and of course recover from exercise. Then he talks about taking deep but short breaths, like if you were sprinting. And the idea is that you're isolating your respiratory system. You're not actually working hard. You're either using it to recover or doing what your respiratory system will be doing when you're sprinting or doing anything kind of fast, right? So let's say my minute ended. Now we're gonna work the power. So a lot of times when I work my power shots, my slips are in there. And I'm just like, I'm going after for a minute. You know, so my round is just all power. When I kick, I'm stepping, I'm trying to take the bag and cut it in half, right? So round one was speed and elusiveness. Round two is power. Now, in the power round, you'll probably move a little less. Like, you're wrenching, rolling back to the power. And you have to imagine you're finishing somebody. You wouldn't be throwing at somebody like that unless you work them and unless you clip them hard, ready to finish them. So knockouts happen two ways. A move with the guy, catch him with a perfect shot, one puts him down. More likely, it's like a TKO, right? Technical knockout. You're working the guy, you clip him. Bang, bang, and then the big shots come right behind it. We say it time and time again in the live classes, like in person. You usually start with speed, you end with power, right? Combinations, fast. Power comes. And the difference between speed and power is just weight transfer. If I throw 1-2 for speed, if I throw for power, I'm gonna settle my weight down. So look, basic jab cross for speed. Just like that, fast as I can go. Just like that. Now for power, I sit on it. I just settle more weight into the shot and I end up doing a lot better, right? Now, so we did speed for round one, power for round two. Kicks only round three, but technical. Not worried about power, so I'm moving with the bag. Bop, bop, I'm working my stuff. I'm there, I'm working my setups. Bang, bang. Just putting my stuff in there, nice and technical for the 3 minutes. Because if you kick straight for 3 minutes, you're probably gonna get really tired, especially after you did a power round. Before a speed round, power round, now the kicks round. So speed with angles, power in round two, kicks in round three. Round four, we've got two more and then we'll kind of break on it a little bit. Infighting. You step onto the bag, either Philly show, hands here. You don't leave the bag, you're here for the entire time. Now, when you're on the inside, a couple of basics. Chin is down, shoulders are high, I'm covered on the sides, my gloves are on my eyebrows, elbows flush against my ribs, bending the knees, more punching center, make sure I'm breathing on the defense, when I slip, breathe, hit out, right? So round number four is infighting. Round number five is a cool one because it's not the way you would normally see somebody hit a bag. I'm gonna show you the technique. Round number five is actually takedowns, specifically the double leg takedown. Big no-no. When you go to shoot at somebody, bending your back and nosediving. No. Look, I'm in my fighting position. I lower my level, big penetration step. It happens at once though. I'm lowering my level and penetrating almost at the same time. So I'm working my stuff, bang, and I lift the bag. I cut the corner, right? So I'm here. Now another thing, when you go to double leg somebody, see what Paul teaches this really well. You never reach like Frankenstein. Think of yourself like a T-Rex. My arms don't extend. I hit you with my shoulder and then I cut the corner, right? So imagine, look, I'm here. Let me get in frame. I lower my level, elbows stay glued to the ribs. Penetration step, trail leg, cut the corner as you lift. So again, lower the level, penetration step, cut the corner as you lift. So you never shoot when you can't touch the bag. If I can't touch the bag, I'm too far. So I'm here, lift the bag, head goes that way. So you're here, and your chin stays on the bag. And those are just five themes that you can use when hitting the bag, right? And they don't have to be these exact same themes. You can change them up, but this is the way I would start. So just to review, speed and angles on round one. Power in round two, kicks only round three, infighting round four, and round five, takedowns. Any questions?
They're asking, should rounds 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 be 20 to 25 minutes?
No. Each round, so let me explain. Sorry, I'm not sure if I understood your question, but let me just answer it. Each round should be 2 to 3 minutes, especially when you start. If you just started, 2 minutes. If you've been here a while, 3 minutes. If you're a veteran, 4 or 5 minutes to keep the pace, right? Especially if you're good cardio, you're in good shape. 30 seconds to a minute off between each round. Now, you can do this differently. You can go longer on shorter. That's just my suggestion. It'll keep your heart rate up. It's good for health too. Like if you start hitting the bag straight for 25, 30 minutes without breaks, you're gonna get really tired. And then what happens is your technique suffers. I want you to be at a pace where of course your heart rate is working. However, you don't wanna be so exhausted that you're not able to keep your hands up. You're not able to keep your chin down. You're not able to bend your knees. Like one of the classic signs of fatigue, especially in a striker, their knees go from bent to straight. Because it takes a little energy to keep your knees bent. Your quads and your hamstrings, your glutes are engaged. Here, this is much more neutral. It's really just my glutes, my quads a little bit. Keep those knees bent when you're firing. Just like that. Firing my stuff. And if I feel myself losing my technique, I back up. I breathe for 10 seconds, I start shadow boxing, I don't hit the bag, and then I get right back to hitting the bag because this progression that I'm showing you, I guarantee you, most of you, and this is just a rule of thumb, if you did my 5 rounds in a row, you'd be exhausted, right? Because it's 5 rounds of actual scoring on the bag and fighting, and it's a hard round because speed is difficult to do, power is difficult to do, kicks are hard to do, infighting's hard to do, and so are takedowns. So we're taking the hardest parts of combat and jamming them into each round. You know, the reason why I did this one today is we get a lot of questions for, hey, Siegel, how do I hit the bag, this, that, and the third. But if I back up a second, and I don't mean this in any kind of a disrespectful way, you just need to know where you are in your training. If you know nothing, don't hit the bag. Just don't. Or when you hit the bag, throw one punch or one kick and work what's called your tool development, working one or two strikes at a time, normally one, right? If you're a veteran, you've been here, then work the bag nice and smooth, nice and easy. The reason why is if you're brand new and you start doing all kinds of crazy combinations, I can pretty much guarantee that your technique will suffer as the combinations go on and as you get more and more fatigued, right? The main thing in the beginning of your training is having your technique, both offensive and defensive, to be picture perfect. Bang, just fire your stuff and learn how to score. Then pace matters, because what's the point of putting a pace on somebody if you're doing it incorrectly? Now, if you've been here a while, a year, 2 years, whatever, hit the bag, work it, do your 4 or 5 rounds. If you can do three and go to 4 the next week, and just work it up nice and slow. See, you know, I'm getting a little older, so I've seen a lot of the trends come and go in the martial art and the fitness industry and stuff like that. One of the big trends now, especially in group classes, is people just stand in front of the bag, and they hit the bag and they do it for cardio, but there could be nothing more fake for combat. Because remember what I said, bags don't hit back, you need to be in motion and simulating combat, right? There's a big difference between the way Floyd Mayweather hits the bag and the way I hit the bag, right? Floyd Mayweather is the best on the planet, and you know, he just does it at such a high level. But then again, there's also a big difference between the way real martial artists hit a bag and a cardio person hits the bag. You want to be that real martial artist, that real Jeet Kune Do practitioner that's able to work their skills on the bag, do them in combinations like I was showing you before, but also do them one at a time. So now I'm going to show you some single direct drills, which is basically one shot at a time that you can fire. And this is where the bag is better than the mitts, like focus mitts, like the mitts that a boxer uses, because unless your partner is carrying a full belly shield, right, like you ever see those body armor shows, it's very hard to hit the body. Right? You can put the mitt down like this and throw a low jab or a low cross, but it's not the same feeling as hitting somebody, right? It's funny, Sifu Teddy and I were training, right? And you know, I'm a big body shot guy, right? So I was hitting the body shots on the mitts, and then he put the body shield on and I hit it again. He's like, oh my God, he's like, it's so different. Because again, the mitts aren't meant to be bashed into that way, right? So let's go round shots first. I go this way, and I just wrench the body. So I go single direct, one slip to rip. This is called slipping to ripping. And I'll throw 10 of them, 12 of them, take a breath and go to my next tool. So we're here, hand stays up until the tool comes out. Breathing, other way, which we're gonna do right now, left dig. And just digging the bag out. I'm here, and just digging the bag out. I'm here, and just digging the bag out. So, hitting the sides. Now, important to hit straight into the belly too. Again, if you have a sparring partner or a foe or you know somebody you don't like that you're gonna fight with, God forbid, they're standing square, obviously hitting the groin, but hitting that belly, you know? I'm a huge believer in body punching and body kicking and kneeing the body. Of course, hitting the legs too, but the body. Your organs are protected by these very, very small bones called your ribs. And if you hit somebody in the liver, which is, these your abs, feel your ribs, on the right side, go midway between, underneath that last rib, that's how you get to the liver. You hit them in the bladder, especially as a guy, guys go down, that's why a boxing cup covers the bladder right underneath or above the belly button, depending on your size and shape. And obviously the groin, right? But even if you're just attacking the body, like legal areas, quote unquote, underneath the belly button, anything in the middle, and the liver specifically. Now that being said, even if you don't hit those areas, the body just, it chips it, guys, right? Now one of the cool tools in Jeet Kune Do, because we lead with our dominant side, is my right jab to the belly, if I'm facing off with another southpaw, hits his liver. So we're out here, we're same lead. Now, when I step in, my head is going to the left. So I'm slipping as my right foot's stepping, coming offline, bang, and the more shots are gonna come right over the top. But for now, we're going single direct, one punch or one kick at a time. So belly shots. Now when I fire this, shoulders up, chin down, glove high on this side, and I'm as covered as I can humanly be at the body, right? Same idea when you fire the back end or the cross to the body. When I land, my chin is down, my shoulders high, and I'm lowering my level. I'm not punching down at the belly, leaving my face exposed. I'm lowering my level, and I'm firing. I'm here, and I'm firing. And again, when I fire this shot, my right glove comes to my face, my shoulders are high, I turn my back foot, hips, legs, and core, and that's where the power comes from.
So Ramon is asking, when you're using your body shots against sparring partners, is it more effective against a person who is skinnier or a little bigger?
It doesn't matter. I mean, a little bit of fat does cover the organs, and it's one of the things that does cover the organs. So I always joke when I eat a lot of chicken and rice or a lot of burgers or something, I have more power and more padding and I can take more damage. But let me tell you something. I've seen big old guys, big fat guys go down with the body shots. I've seen the six-pack abs go back with the body shots. Body shots don't discriminate. Body shots don't discriminate. Male, female, tall, short, fat, skinny, muscular, whatever. Doesn't matter. Like, eventually they'll break through. Because I don't care who you are. Watch world championship kickboxers. They get their body dug enough times, they go down. We're human, right? We can be hurt. Like, martial arts has proved one thing. We can definitely be hurt, but it also proves how resilient the human body and the human mind is. Because you could probably take a lot more damage than you think that you can. You just have to condition yourself to do it, right? Like, you know, there's like the little drills where like you punch your own belly or you have somebody just touch your belly between the rounds. That stuff does work because it's more mental. But there's a point where the force is so much, it's in the right place, like literally your ribs will break. You know, just a fun stat, if you guys know who Bas Rutten is, he's one of the UFC Hall of Famers, actually. He's like one of the original heavyweight champions. Old school Dutch kickboxer, heavyweight, crazy guy. Crazy. Like, he almost beat up a couple of football players in a bar and all this crazy stuff. They measured his roundhouse kick against a crash test dummy. If you look it up, it's called Fight Science. It was a great episode. And they had done like chokes, but also just the brute force of his roundhouse kick. Now, he threw a roundhouse kick at the chest of a crash test dummy. And they determined that he was hitting with enough force per square inch, or you know, pounds per square inch on his force, that he would literally concave your chest and the bones would start stabbing your heart. Now, let me repeat that. Your chest would concave and the bones would start stabbing your heart. That's from a roundhouse kick to the chest. That's crazy. That's absolutely crazy. Like, you know, they've measured the shin kick, like a kick like this. And they said it's equivalent to someone swinging a baseball bat at your leg. So if you think you're tough and you think you can take leg kicks, well, let somebody who knows what they're doing do it and just attack your leg over and over and over and over and over and over again. If you think you're really tough, let somebody attack your body and see how long you last. My whole point is that some, you know, rather foolish people will say, well, I can take a punch or I can take a kick. You may be able to, but how many can you take and from who, right? Because it really matters who's throwing the punches. Is it some big, strong fighter that's coming after you? Or is it the guy that recreationally trains once a week and, you know, he does some cardio and he thinks he's tough? Big difference. Big, 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 big difference, right? So another thing, you know, we beat the punches to death and we can go to the hand and the bag for sure. The bag is great to kick, right? One thing. The bag is great to kick, right? So if I want to hit that belly, bah! Ball of the foot, I just keep my range here. Ball the foot right into the midsection. Now, your front kick is your most basic kick in all of fighting. And by the way, the rear leg front kick, little secret, was one of Bruce Lee's favorite kicks because it was the simplest kick in fighting. And to add a technique to Jeet Kune Do, it needs to be simple, it needs to be direct, and it needs to be non-classical, which means it needs to come from a non-classical lens. It needs to be a kinetics and physics as a lens instead of the classical side. Now, good shot though, because the ball of your foot can again hit that liver, hit the middle, hit the bladder, and of course it could hit the groin. When you throw your rear leg front kick, try this at home. Keep the leg that's planted completely flat on the floor and your toes facing the bad guy. Now when I hit things, there's always equally yet opposite force coming back at me, right? So when your leg is flat, you have more balance, more power. And again, when the recoil comes back, the balance really matters. So when I'm here, I keep my foot flat, just like that, I lift, and then I can try to time it. Just like that, I'm moving, and just throw that rear leg front kick. My whole point is you can pick any tool and work it single direct on the bag, right? A tool that some people have problems with, depending on the dexterity of their hips. I know I did, especially early in my training, because I wasn't the world's most flexible guy, right? It's weird, because like, I'm not that flexible, but I can throw head kicks, right? But if you ask me to like do a split, I can't do it. It's just like weird martial arts stuff. Your hips just get used to doing certain things, right? Now, when you throw a side kick, part of it's flexibility and dexterity, but part of it, I'm just getting framed, is this back foot turning, which allows my hips to open and allows my heel to score on the back. So when I'm here, I'm just side kicking, it lets me lift my knee. Now, I'm trying to do that slow. Side kick's kind of hard to demo slow, but I'm going to do it slow for you anyway. This foot slides in, turns. Lead leg lifts, and I extend. Heel to his midsection. Your heel is fortified by your tibia, your fibia, and your femur is right behind it. So again, we're here, we're breathing. Retract your leg. So that's slow. Just touch it. Retract your leg. You're here. Retract your leg. And you should be able to keep your balance. So there's a few subtle things happening there. My back foot is turning. My lead knee is lifting at the height that I want it to go, in this case, to the belly. And then, on the moment of impact or after I'm done, I retract my knee as a shock absorber because I know that there will be equal yet opposite force when I land. Just like that. One more. Just like that. So the Bruce Lee made the side kick famous, and you're seeing more of them in MMA, right? Steven Wonderboy Thompson is another traditional martial artist that made his way into MMA. It's kind of cool because he's bladed like we are. Throws a lot of lead leg kicks like we do, still throws that vicious roundhouse kick, right? But he does throw a lot of side kicks, right? Guy's there, he's like poking him with the side kick, double kicking him, and all sorts of fancy stuff. And a lot of the MMA guys that come from a traditional Muay Thai background or boxing background, have a very hard time with him because he's also very in and out of the sport. He's taking angles, he's firing, he's angling. He's never in one spot as just a punching bag or prey to be hit, right? So when you're working your stuff, when you're working your tool development, you have to make sure that the tool is sharp, right? Like, you're throwing it well, it's fast, it's strong, it'll do damage. But then also learning to add it to your game and working your setups. You know, we could do a whole class on setups, but the idea matters more than the actual moves themselves, because there's a million setups, right? There's like an old school thing, like this is probably before a lot of your time in terms of training, but some karate guys, not all of them, some karate guys were freaking crazy, which I'll tell you about in a second, but some karate guys, they would like throw these picture perfect kicks in the air. And then you would watch them spar because they never hit a mitt, they never hit a tie pad. The transition between hitting the air and hitting a live person is very hard. Now there's a progression. You work the tool in the air, you work the tool on some kind of focus mitt or a bag, then the thing starts moving around, right? So you try to time the bag on the way in, you try to time the kicking shield, which is like the shield that we hold as the guy's moving around with you, to try to make it real. I see the opening, bang, I score now, right? Not just when I decide, so the partner decides. And then what you do is theme assault sparring, where I'm moving around with you, I'm only allowed to use my lead leg. Nothing else, just my lead leg. And if your lead leg development is weak, you've probably hit it with other things that aren't as weak. Like, some guys have vicious hands, and then they just throw kicks at the end of the combo, and it's easy because the guy's right there. But scoring on somebody as they're moving and advancing at somebody is a much more difficult, much more high-level skill. So let's go through the progression again. You learn your technique, solo, in the air. Then you hit something, like a bat, over and over again. Then you time the bag. Then, Tammy, get a kicking shield, please. You get a kicking shield with a partner, right? We don't have to do it with each other just for safety and stuff. But a kicking shield is just this thing that Tammy's gonna bring on frame in a second. And we do it in class all the time, the members know this. Like, guy's moving around, he flashes it, I kick it, and I'm moving in really, so he flashes it, now I kick it, and I have to follow Temi in this case, so now I'm not in charge. Last thing you do before real sparring is theme assault sparring. We each go, we're both using our lead leg. Or I'm using my lead leg, you get to use your hands. And you can mix that. And it's a fun way to play in sparring, and you can up the intensity, keep it lower, whatever your heart desires, right? Whatever you prefer. See, the difference between a good martial artist and a great one is training modalities. Right? You have to have drills that are real, like they're real, right? Like sparring, things that are close to combat. But the trick is, for longevity purposes, you have to keep those drills as safe as possible so that you, the practitioner, don't get so hurt that you're not able to continue after a couple of years, right? So remember, this is a marathon. It is not a sprint, right? In a few minutes, I'm gonna have Sue Temi come in and show you some combinations and cool things on the bag and just a couple of different ways to work them. But I want you guys thinking, right? We always tell you, this is the thinking person's art. It is not just about you going and bashing things. It is about you learning the modalities and learning how to get better as a practitioner. It's being calculated, for lack of a better term, in your training mechanisms, right? Like, it's really not good to just walk up to the bag and just do random stuff. You go, oh, I trained today, what did you work? I don't know. Remember the rounds, speed, power, kicks, infighting, takedowns. That's a good way where I'm working five different things across five rounds. I'm knocking out my fitness and my self-defense in one drill, which is awesome. And then I can rest and do it again tomorrow, right? So I'm gonna pass it over to Steve Temi. He's gonna kind of get you guys a couple of things in the bag, and I'm gonna hop back on a little bit later, okay? Thank you guys.
All right, guys. So since we are sticking to the kicking thing, let's do some kicks, right? So, what I want to start off with you guys is just working that lead hook kick and also putting the rear leg behind it momentarily after. But let's start with that lead pendulum hook kick. So the first thing you guys are going to do is, in the past few videos, we talked about the different ranges of throwing the rear leg, the pendulum kick, right? First, you want to start off by getting the technique and the form. You don't want to start off at range and just start from sliding in, hitting that lead hook kick. you want to start right in front of the bag. So we're going to work the technique portion of the kick. So we're going to open up this back foot. That's going to allow my hip to open up so my lead hip could turn and I can land my shin. But I don't want to land the side of my ankle because I'm going to end up hurting myself. And at the end of my kicking session here on the bag, I'm going to end up in pain. I'm going to start kind of limping like I saw one of the comments earlier on the YouTube section. That after a round of hitting bag at the end of the session, you ended up limping because you ended up probably hitting the wrong part of your leg. So that's very important stuff to be aware of, especially in the earlier stages of your training. You don't want to end up rushing in, going for power, and just hitting improperly, because that's how you take yourself out, right? And you will be unable to train because you've injured yourself, and that's always not a good, pleasant thing to be dealing with. So again, you're at range, you open up that back foot, you turn your hip, you land with the shin, right? Not the ankle, not the instep, right, with the toes, but with the shin. Now again, let's talk about hand placement. Rear hand is up, hand meets your knee halfway, so that way we work our lever, which is gonna help us with balance, and you just go, see? And I'm still able to generate power. And again, I'm not the biggest, strongest guy out there, but I'm still able to hit hard every single time, because again, I'm working my mechanics, right? Everybody wants to be able to hit hard, but no one wants to put in the work that is required for you to learn how to hit hard, right? Everybody is just so impressed going, right? Like, oh, look at that power. Look at that kick. So strong, right? Powerful. But no one ever stops and looks at how was the person able to hit that hard. No one questions what made that person hit that hard. Everybody just focuses on power. Power is great enough, but if you can't generate the force, doesn't matter how hard someone hits, if you can't break it down and pretty much see why he's able to hit hard, or that person's able to hit hard, then you try to replicate it, and now you ended up hitting with the wrong part of your leg, or you end up injuring yourself, blowing your knee out in the process, then that's gonna take you out, and then that's no good. So again, in range, open up that back foot, turn your lead hip behind that shin, kicking up. Good. So now that we've got that out of the way, now we're gonna work that slide forward. So I bring that back foot, and I don't want to crisscross. I want that back foot to kick out and replace my lead leg, and I go as I kick. Now I try to do this as slow as possible so you guys can see a little better. I slide, and again, I land my shin, not the side of my foot, which is my ankle, or land with my instep or toes. I want to land flush with that shin every single time. And again, notice, right now, not working power, more or less working the placement on my shin with the bag. Again, as I get comfortable, you can speed it up a little bit. And look, every single time, I'm landing flush. Now, once I get really, really comfortable, I start hacking away. Speed it up a little bit. I start hitting harder. And even harder. So now let's put that pendulum hook kick in transition with the rear leg hook kick. But before I get into that, let's talk about the rear leg hook kick. And again, placement is very, very important. Just like your lead hook kick, you want to start by turning your hip, landing the kick with your shin, and in order to hit with power, see this front foot? You have to open it. So that way your hip comes through and you don't blow out your own knee in the process. So I'm here and I land that shin, right, on the heavy bag. I'm here. And again, notice, not hitting hard yet, just working the mechanics. Right, nice and easy. Now as I get comfortable, I can speed it up. And the more comfortable we get, again, I can pick up the pace, I can put in a little more and more power as I throw that rear leg hook kick. So now, let's put that pendulum hook kick and the rear leg hook kick together. So what I'm gonna go here is I'm gonna start off at long range, I'm gonna slide up, boom, throw that rear pendulum hook kick. Now here's the problem. I'm too close now to be throwing that rear leg hook kick. So this is where your footwork comes into play. I don't wanna go and then jam my kick. So I'm gonna step off to a 45. So I'm gonna do one of these. I slide up, step out, so I can create enough space for me to throw that rear leg hook kick. So I'm here. See, now all of a sudden, I'm able to hit that rear leg hook kick at full extension without jamming myself and losing any power. And just a little rule of thumb. You never want to go in front of your opponent's tools, right? Because if I'm here, bam, I run into a shot, two shots. I don't want to deal with that. I'm here. One. I take my head offline by doing this. One, I shift, boom. Throw that rear leg hook kick. So again, pendulum hook kick to that rear leg hook kick. Nice and slow. One, two. And again, I create more power because I'm zoning off. I'm opening up those hips. So I'm here. One, bam. Taking the leg right off. One, bam, right there. Now a little faster, and I'm right there, again. Once more, and again, devastating the guy, hitting him and his leg from one side, and then hitting it on the outside. So targets, if the person is in the same lead as you, you're hitting the inside, and then you destroy him on the other side. So you go in here, hitting him in the inside, he retracts, okay, boom. You're closing the gap by stepping off out of 45.
Does the rear leg go straight in, or does your knee cross your body?
It goes through. It
goes right through, right? So that's a good question. When you throw the rear leg hook kick, correct? In the past videos we did, I believe it was on a Wednesday night, right?
So it was a couple days ago.
However, when you throw a really hook, you want to believe there's a wall right next to your leg. If you open up, you hit the wall, no good. You want your knee to travel in a straight line like this. What determines the rear leg front kick to a rear leg hook kick is the rotation of your front foot. Right? If I want to throw a rear leg front kick, see, my knee's traveling straight. So if I'm here, if I throw that rear leg hook kick, notice, knee still travels in that same direction, but my front foot determined the angle in which I ended up in. So if I'm here, versus, and it's such a subtle change, what makes this very non-telegraphic because it has the same look as a rear leg front kick, but I could always flip it over to a rear leg hook kick just by simply doing this. Pivoting on the balls of my front foot. So that way you guys can see over here, boom, boom. So it could be here or it could be here. So that determines that angle of a rear leg front kick and a rear leg hook kick as well. So now, this is a combination of the hands transitioning with that rear leg hook kick. So on that range, I go pop, pop, right? On the 1-2. Pop, pop. I can do this one stationary, right? Jab, cross. So now the trick here is, on that range, I can't hit that rear leg hook kick, right? It's never gonna land, and no one's ever gonna let me land this power shot. From right here, the person's gonna make a miss, and I'm gonna need a couple of shots, right? So I'm here, pop, pop, right after that cross hits, you fire that rear leg hook kick. You don't wanna go and take 1-2, you stay there, bring the hand back and then go. You've already stunned the guy, you already bridged the gap, take the real estate you just got, right? I'm here, and I'm right there, right? 1-2. So subtle, right? Now, another thing, you don't wanna stay in front as well, so you kinda wanna go off line
so that way you don't run into shots. So we can go and step off. And one, two, right here. One more time. I go out of 45. Takes again your head offline as just a squirt. One, two, bam. And you're right there. You can hit this to the body, to the leg, right? So I'm here. Pop, pop. Landing. A little lower, right? Pop, pop. Maybe the kneecap. Blow out the kneecap. Pop, pop. Body shot. Depending on how flexible you are as well, you could always aim this towards the head as well. And you want to get really fancy, a little more risky, but high reward. So you go pop, pop, body. Now, I'm not as flexible, so I wouldn't be risking that type of kick. But if I was, and I see the line, why not? Go pop, pop, right here. Body. All day, every day. Leg. Same exact thing. Now, other things you could do. Let's say, kick to punch. So I'm gonna bridge the gap now. I'm gonna go pendulum kick. This question?
No, I just.
So I'm gonna go kick to punch. So now I'm too far. I can't reach with my straight. I can't reach with my jab cross. So now I'm gonna utilize my footwork and I'm gonna bridge the distance with a pendulum hook kick or a pendulum front kick. So let's go with the hook. So I'm here, I slide, I go, bam. Then I go cross, then I curve out at 45, finishing off that hook. Right, so I can go here, bam. Throw that rear straight, finish off that curving hook. You could finish off with a corkscrew punch, you could double up that rear hand. It's personal preference there. But again, just showing you a couple of tools you can use while working the heavy bag, right? I'm going here. Again, I'm working my way offline in transition. And notice, I don't want to do this. Hit, land, then go, land, then go, land. So much more slower, and it's unpractical, and the chance of you pulling this off in that manner is not high. But if I'm here, bam, 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 it's a lot quicker, a lot smoother. And the transition and the time it took me to get from point A to point B was a lot quicker and a shorter amount of time. So again, I'm here. Bam, bam, bam. And notice, subtle, right? So I'm showing to you guys here. I'll go one, two, three. And I'm right back into my stance. One more time. Hook kick, rear straight, corkscrew. And I'm right back into my stance. One more time. Bam, bam, bam. Other little details. When you throw that hook kick, boom, rear hand, slide up to the target. Now notice what happens to my front hand. It came from my knee, comes up to my face, just in case a punch, right, comes in my direction, I have some sort of defense. That's the secondary thing. Primary thing, my hand is now primed and facing the target.
Good question.
To throw that punch.
Ramon asks, is the cross after the kick a power shot or a probe that's used to angle out?
Both. You could use it as both, but really, it's a power shot. Let me explain why. I could easily go hook kick straight from here, but there's not as much rotational force behind it as if I were to throw that cross. So what's happening is, look, I go one. Most of my weight has already shifted to my left. So when I step off at a 45, bam, I'm just dropping and doing right the body transfer from this leg here and transferring it over to my front leg. So I'm here. Bam, whoosh, bam. And again, when you throw that rear straight or across in general, you don't want to just go whoosh, take a piece, upright. You're going to drop your weight whoosh, and go here, whoosh, right here. Right? Because there's four ways you generate power. Linear, drop, up, and rotational force. So again, as I'm going here, bam, whoosh, shift, whoosh, shift. So that's how you generate power. You could set up, right? You could probe it, you go one touch, and then throw, right, that following shot. It'll be a lot quicker, but you want to deal damage, right? It'll be a little more slower, but have more power. It'll have a lot more power. Right over here.
if you're just touching, you go. See, my follow-up shot is a lot quicker. Right after that touch, bam, bam, bam. That hand comes in a lot quicker. Third punch, I have more power. Second one loses a little power because you're just touching. But you still want to hit with power. You're going here. And you're hitting while you're in transition. So that's a good question, Lamar. Now, you can flip this over from the head to the body, right? And as you guys know, we are very big fanatics of hitting the body. So we're here. Go one. Body shot. You stay right there. And you just dig right with that shovel hook with your lead hand. So I'm here. Bam, bam. And you're right there. One more time. Now, just a little thing for you guys to keep in mind. This one you're still in front of their tools, right? So just a couple of things for you guys to keep in mind. You're gonna go one, two. You're still in front of the person's tools. Right after that rear hand to the body, cover up high. Because again, you're still in front of the guy. You don't wanna go, boom, you land it. And then you drop your guard. I should throw that lead shovel hook, boom. You get clipped over one or one, two. That wouldn't be the best thing for you after you have hit that picture perfect right combination, keeping your guard up right here. And you're right there, right? You could also, right, one, body right up the middle with that uppercut. Boom, right there. Or again, like I said, since we're big believers in hitting the body shots, right, we're here, and you're right back. Again. Boom. You're hitting the legs, bam, another thing about the legs, hitting the body, and you're wrenching that shovel. Other things. You go here, pendulum front kick, straight lead, drop off, hit the body shot with the rear hand now. So I'm here. You hit the guy, let's say, in the knee, pills, right? Your choice, whichever you feel more comfortable with at the time. Bam, he drops up, hit the body shot right there. One more time. Right there. More, a little slower, pendulum front kick, straight lead. Right after this hand detaches, you drop off, and you shift your weight into that body shot. One more time. And again, this one's really nasty because you're going down the middle, hitting the head, and using this as a post, right? And you just drop off, and then that body shot comes in. Momentarily, seconds afterwards. You don't want to go here. One, hit. Take a second. Take another little second, and then hit. You're giving your opponent one too many seconds to recover. No, no, no. You want to think. We want to hit this combination in transitions, and bang, bang, bang. One, two, three. You're here. You want to give your opponent no time to recover, dealing the most amount of damage as quickly as you can. So you go here, and you can follow up with other tools, right? Let's say after that rear body shot, you finish off with a knee hook. It'll look like this. Again, since I'm a little closer, it depends on where your opponent goes. If the person moves towards the left, you step out to the left, you finish and follow up with that lead hook kick. If the person is still in the same spot, you just turn your hips by opening up that back foot. So this is where we talk about adapting to your opponent, right? You don't want to just go bam, bam. You plan on the person going that way, but now your opponent goes all the way over there. Now you're like, oh no, your follow-up is gone. No, 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 no. This is why, I think it was last week, I was talking about, we have this saying, I don't fear the man that's thrown 10,000 kicks once, but I fear the man that's thrown one kick 10,000 times. Now, that person hasn't thrown that kick 10,000 times in one specific way, meaning. And I've done that 10,000 times. Now I'm a master. No, no, no. I'm here, right? Stationary hooking. I slide. The bag is moving forward and back. So now I'm working my timing. As it comes in, I have that. Now the bag is going side to side, right? Now I want to hit it going this direction. I step to the left. Now I want to hit it as it comes in, right? So going side to side, I throw it through court. So now I'm here. So now I'm working that pendulum hooking in different situations. But now I'm adapting, right? I'm no longer in front of the bag, stationary. No longer working it from range. Now what if I'm too close? Open up, then quick switch. So again, I want to be able to adapt to my opponent and the current situation I'm in. So I'm here. And I'm right there. One more time. And I'm right back and ready to engage. Maybe I want to end off with a punching combination. Not a kick. No problem. Hit the body, and then finish up by hitting the head. So I'm here. And I'm right back into my stance. So I'm here. And you're wrenching, you're unloading, you're going bam, bam. Body, head. So if you notice, I took a little tiny step on the body shot to the, right, that hook to the body. And then I just stood up, boom, and hit hook stationary. Again, being able to play, generating power in different ways. Stepping, stationary, pushing back, curving back. Being able to be a master of the tools you're throwing is very, very important, especially in the early stages of your training. Because I could, again, sit here. If I practice this for 6 months, the same way I'm throwing it right now, sure, I will get better at it. But now here's the problem.
Tell me, hold on.
Just click the camera.
Where?
Right to the right.
Show them.
One second, guys. There you go. All right, we're back. So, again, I don't want to just train myself to hit this hook, right? Stationary here, no hip rotation, just arm punching. Anyone could do that, any problem, any time of the day. And here's the problem. You're not really working your technique. So, punch like this, missing out on power like that. Again, now that's just me working body mechanics. Again, that's a lot more harder and power, because again, I'm using mechanics. And now I'm not injuring myself in the process, which is the best part. Now I can curve off. All right, I can roll back. I can step back. I can push in. Step left. Step right. And still generate the same amount of power. No problem. Anytime. And again, it's not costing me to go off and get tired where I'm exhausted to the point where I can't throw any more punches. Have questions here?
No, they're just coming in.
So yeah.
There's one question I'm gonna answer after.
So yeah, we're here. Front kick. Straighten. Close. Step off. Come back to the body. Come back to the head. So again, we're about in for the question marks. Right, so if you guys have any questions, myself and Steve James will answer them to the best of our ability.
So Ramon asked a good question. Is calisthenics or weight training better for martial arts? So I'm going to give you a very thorough answer because I've researched this a lot and I've done both, right? I think a lot of you have done both. So you got to understand, calisthenics are normally bodyweight exercises. Think about like push-ups, squats, what's called pull-ups, dips, things of that nature. Now in general, and Firas Sahabi talks about his old GSP's old coaching talks, he prefers calisthenics because the recovery time in calisthenics is typically a lot less. Like let's say I did push-ups, sit-ups, squats, lunges, and I even did them in longer sets. I mean, need a day or two to recover, then I'm back to training right away. If I lifted heavy, like specifically lifting heavy. Like let's say I was deadlifting, squatting with weight on my back, leg pressing heavy, bench pressing heavy. The problem is your recovery time will be like 3 or 4 days for you to come back to training if you were lifting that heavy. And if you weren't lifting that heavy, you probably weren't doing it properly or your form was off or something like that. Now, the reason I bring this up is your main activity in martial arts should be martial arts. Just like if I was a wrestler or a basketball player or a football player, my main activity would be football, basketball, or wrestling. Same thing in martial arts, my main activity should be martial arts. So Firas Sahabi's idea is that you do calisthenics because let's say 80% of your training is actually martial art training, and perhaps 20% of your training would be like physical training, like jogging or calisthenics or weightlifting. Now you gotta understand that there's something called eccentric load, which means like, think of like a bench press, it's the negative. On the way down, it actually has you working a lot. Like if I just bench press and someone magically took the bar off of me, then put it back down on my chest and I bench pressed again. So think of my example. I push it up, then two people just literally held it, put it back on my chest and I pressed up. It's not as hard as if I was bench pressing, then holding the weight for let's say 3 or 4 seconds on the eccentric load. Now the eccentric load, the eccentric part of the exercise is the part that gets you very fatigued, very tired, and depletes like your glucose systems, right? So that takes more recovery time. And when you listen to Firas Sahabi, he hates CrossFit and people that train like CrossFit practitioners, because the whole point of CrossFit is to get you so exhausted that you're like, literally, like you shouldn't be able to work out the next day. Like, and sometimes these guys do, and then they get very hurt because the exercise have a lot of weight, they're doing cleans and things like that. But if your body is really, really, really tired, and then you go into training, the chances of you being injured is much higher, right? Like, everybody's probably read, like, Bruce Lee got hurt doing good morning exercise, which is put the bar on your back, bend your knees a little bit, and you just bend straight down and come up. Get your lower back very strong, your glutes and all that stuff. You put too much weight on the rack. But also, he was probably overtrained because, you know, Bruce Lee's training regimen was like a famous 7 or 8 hours. It'd be like an hour on, 20 minutes off. He'd be hitting the bag like 1,000 times, all these crazy things. He was lifting weights, he was jogging. And the truth is, Bruce is the pioneer of fitness as it's related to martial arts. You gotta understand, in the late 60s, early 70s, martial arts didn't lift weights. Maybe boxers jogged, and they did some calisthenics, but they believed in the old days that weights made you slow. There's actually no evidence of this now. It's just really that weights, especially heavy weights, take a long time for you to recover, and therefore it may be a detriment to your martial arts training. That being said though, if you're willing to look at this like a marathon, let's say on Monday I did martial arts, and then I took a day off, and on Wednesday I lifted, I'd probably lift light. I'd probably do about 60-70% of what I can actually do because I want to train again on Friday. Do you want to give yourself a day off in between? It's not the end of the world if you don't, but for the marathon thing, you need to give yourself enough rest. I hope that answered your question thoroughly. Any other questions? We are in the questions section of the class now. Anything about martial arts, anything about Bruce Lee, anything about the stuff we've done, or things that you guys want to see, I'm happy to answer both on YouTube and on Instagram. Any questions? Okay. I'll just show you guys one more quick little thing you guys can do in the bag, and we'll probably do more of it in the next couple of drills. So this simulates a tie clinch, by the way, where, you know, you'd be hand on hand on the back of somebody's neck, or you're trying to pinch your elbows together and holding them down so you can start kneeing them, right? So the way you work it on the bag, you grab the side of the bag and you do what's called skipping knees. You skip your legs back. And you know, we used to say like, this is a conditioning drill, but it's also there to have the onslaught on the body. Now there's a few little mechanics things. You could obviously use this for cardio and to get in shape, but a few mechanics things I really want you guys to pay attention to. When you knee someone or something, your toes are down, your heels towards your butt, and your knee is like a spear, it gets bladed. So I'm here, I make my knee sharp. Now look, when this foot plants, my other leg goes straight back, and I knee again. I can come around the bag, straight in the middle of the bag, fake around, then come in the middle, whatever I decide. But the whole point is you don't want to do this. You don't want to knee the bag, plant this foot, step your foot back, let it hit the floor, and fire. My back leg is never hitting the floor. Bang, just like that. And again, it's just a nice, easy drill that you can do if you have access to a bag. You bring it back. Solo training in martial arts is very important, but in my humble opinion, it's nowhere near as good as partner training. So just to repeat, solo training is good, shadow boxing, hitting the bag, conditioning, whatever, is great, but it is nowhere near as good as partner training. Obviously now it's very hard to partner train because of the whole COVID thing. And that being said, I don't know what's gonna happen with this COVID thing in terms of people and their health insurance. I mean, you know, the president was saying like, they're gonna like not have premiums. Like, so like, let's say I went to the doctor, I may not have to pay a premium, but it's all up in the air. So if this COVID thing does go crazy and people get killed in medical bills, raiselovefoundation.org is the place to look. We give money for families in need for specifically medical bills. So maria'slovefoundation.org gives money for families in need for medical bills. If this COVID thing goes crazy, from a bill perspective, we're going to be here to help. And we usually give for like St. Mary's Children's Hospital, for like wheelchairs for kids, people that are sick of all different types of diseases, whether it's a chromosomal disease and it's just hard to, you know, keep up with the expenses for a family, or if family gets sick, or the breadwinner in a family gets sick and they can't pay the bills. That's what we're here for. Quick little digress. But to get back to the martial arts, you know, another thing, like let's say you're in the bag, working the elbows. So I'm working, my knee is bent, and I'm hitting with my elbow. And when you elbow, you actually hit with the hard part of the elbow, not your forearm. The little quarter that's right here on the elbow slices, does a lot of damage, and it's actually a lot harder than your hands. The problem is it lacks reach and short. So again, if you guys don't have any other questions, we're gonna close out for today. Enjoy Sunday. We're going to be back on for the adults 7 to 8 p.m. every weeknight. For the kids, it's going to be Tuesday and Thursday from 6 to 6:30. Again, guys, enjoy the weekend. I had a lot of fun today. Just like all the other days training with you guys, and I can't wait to see everybody back on the training floor. Thank you so much.